guys. We're gonna forge ahead here with public opinion. Yes, normally I do this another way, but the book is set up this way, so instead of hitting political culture right now, we're going to hit polling, public opinion, so on and so forth. Then I'm gonna put up a web quest, I've got to change some things to the setup. I forgot it's set up for the election 2012, and that really doesn't have anything to do with what we're doing right now. Now we know that there are a couple of things in which public opinion measures. And we divide these into three groups. One is the elite group, which is probably the smallest, but it's the one that wields the most power. And then in the middle is attentive, and then at the bottom is mass, which again has the most, as far as numbers go, but the least amount of power. So we know that when you look at public opinion, this is what we call the definition. It's the opinions of people about elected officials, about candidates, public policy, government institutions. It could be a polling to measure your reflections on your personal values, about beliefs, about attitudes. Polls tomorrow, because I'm just trying to lecture once a week again. So your values, if we break that down, your values simply mean that these are the basic guiding goals and priorities that you have in your life. These are your values. These are the things that you hold dear in life. If Cameron thinks that women are dirt bags and they're only there to be punched around and treated like dogs, that's the value that he has. Of course, he's not like that. But those are values that he would carry in the most base way, of course. Now, a belief is the understanding of events and the visions of the future that you have for yourself, your family, and society in general. And then attitude would be your judgments about the interactions of life, of everyday life. And what public opinion then does is it creates that linkage between public opinion and government policy. Lots of government officials stick their finger up in the air to see which way the wind is blowing. They look at polls. They commission lots of polls. The government itself commissions polls to see where the population is on an issue. Doesn't mean that they're going to follow it, but they don't want to be too far out of step with the population at large. So for instance, this administration has really gotten out of step with what the population wants. And you can see that by one of the things that we're going to look at, we're going to be looking at tomorrow, the polling generally across the board, doesn't matter which organization you look at, says we're on the wrong pathway. And this administration says, no, we're going to continue on this one. And every month, the gap between where they're going and where the population thinks, or Americans think it should be, gets wider and wider, which is why you see in a lot of states, presidents polling, do you think you can do the job or not? This is down in the mid-30s, which is not a good place for a president to be, to say the least. Now, let's look at the policy that the three groups espouse. Now, the elites, first and foremost, have a great deal of political resources. In fact, they have a disproportionate amount of the resources that are offered in the society. So, obviously, it's going to be the elite that molds the lives, and sometimes different issues are. And then it tries to mold your viewpoint on those issues because they have a disproportionate amount of resources. So they have the resources. They raise the issues. They help set the national agenda. And they influence the resolution of those issues. So consequently, that's why they're the most important group. Now, an attentive public is people like me. I really put myself in the attentive area. I have an active interest in government politics. I teach it. First thing I look at in the morning is not my Facebook. It's my Real Clear Politics. I rarely look at Facebook, but I look at Real Clear Politics. What are the stories that are getting highlighted today? I don't generally, because I don't have the money, I don't put money into candidates. It's funny, this year I re-registered my address, and suddenly I was getting, because I re-registered with Union Canada, I was suddenly getting emails from both sides. We need money. Every day I'd open up my email, 5, 6, 7 messages from Democrats and Republicans asking me for money. Not giving it. Now, the mass is probably, unfortunately, probably everybody down Magnus' class, and Ortiz's class this morning, but it's those that have little interest in government politics without realizing that their lack of interest means that they're never going to get what they want simply because they think, since they don't have any political efficacy, internal political efficacy, or external political efficacy, which means that they don't think it will change the outcome, they turn their backs on the system and go about their daily lives. They'll complain about what they don't get, or they'll complain about what they perceive as problem, but since they're not part of the system, really just can't give them any sort of sympathy about how they feel, since they're not willing to put the time in. And the time sometimes just be registering to vote and participating in the process. That's all it is. But elites, probably more than 5%, attentive, maybe 25-30%, the rest of them are fans. Which is why 50% of eligible voters, because they're 18 and above as an eligible voter, don't even register to vote. And then in many cases, like Judson and Richard, 50% of them don't vote. So what you have is maybe a quarter of the population deciding what the rest of us will follow. And I'd rather be on the inside than outside, so I vote. I've missed one election since 1974. A school board election up here in the 90s. Completely forgot. Completely forgot. So therefore, didn't vote. It's the only time I've ever voted. All right, now, this is something that's not in your book at all, but it's something that is in other books, and we have to look at it. Because there are a lot of types of opinions. There are 8 here that I've looked at. The first one is what we call stable, and that means that it changes very little. So the public opinion on, let's say, the death penalty has remained rather constant since the 1960s. About 2/3 of Americans, or now it's down to about 60% of Americans, feel that the death penalty is valid. About 1/3 to 40% of Americans feel that we should get rid of it. But it's been really stable. Very little has moved at more than 1 or 2 points on the public opinion scale. So that's what we call a stable opinion. Abortion is not a stable opinion. We'll see why in a minute. Now, a fluid opinion is what we're seeing right now. When I looked at my emails this morning, as I was laying there in bed, the very first thing I got was a Real Clear Politics email with a lady calling, which meant that I could see a number of races for the Senate that are up, and those races are very, very fluid. In fact, in D.C., in some cases, had one candidate ahead, but another poll had the other candidate ahead. So it's very fluid. Presidential popularity polls are very fluid. The president can be down in the dumps, but let's say something really earth-shaking happens, and suddenly the polling is up here. So, for instance, in 1991, President Bush's presidential '41, his polling was off the charts because we just had Operation Desert Storm. 95% of Americans thought he was doing a good job. 95%. He lost the election in 1992. So that exhibits a great deal of fluidness, of change. And it didn't help that President Bush went into a store and didn't know the cost of loaf of bread. Now, in his defense, he's president of the United States. What president goes out and buys his own groceries? And before that, he was vice president of the United States. What vice president goes out and buys their own groceries? They don't. So there was a disconnect. Obviously, Americans felt that the president didn't know the kind of stresses that they were undergoing in everyday life. And so, therefore, they felt that that disconnect must go across the board. And that was one of the reasons that President Bush lost. Now, it was also a very unique three-way race, you know, with Ross Perot and no, it's the random samples, and we're going to talk about that a little bit later today. And how it has to be. Because the groupings are rather small. But because of the way they select groups, those groups represent a much greater population. All right, latent. That means that these are dormant, but, and this is perfect for you guys, especially if you're a guy, what did guys have to do when they turned 18? We need to be talking about the possible and reality. Right, you have to register for selective service. Do girls have to do that? No, and guys at this point suddenly this opinion like, why do I have to do it and girls don't? How fair is that? And they're right. Females should have to register for selective service too. Don't you want equal rights? Yeah. You got to do the good with the bad, right? Now, the fourth type of opinion is what we call intense. Now, this could be a person who is for or against the death penalty, or abortion, or any event that creates a flame inside, and you are suddenly very, very passionate about whatever it is that's being measured. So, you know, you guys have had intense opinions. A non-intense opinion is like, whatever, I don't care. Yeah, whatever they're gonna do it anyways. You know? All right, now, salient. Now, these have some personal importance to individuals. So, James Brady, who was shot in the head, James Brady died recently. He was the president's press secretary, President Reagan's press secretary in 1981 when he was shot. After he was shot, they had to remove part of his brain here. And so his forehead had a permanent indentation. It affected his speech. He could no longer obviously serve as the president's press secretary. But he was then became a proponent of gun control because it was personal to him. Candy Leitner, who's she? Anybody know? Candy Leitner. 10 years ago, kids would have known immediately who she is. Mothers Against Drunk Driving. She lost her daughter to a drunk driver, NAD, which is her organization. Her opinions on drinking and driving were preach to them. They would sell you. So the second thing is one that has some personal importance to you. And so they're out there. President Obama's wife, Michelle Obama, and the issue of school lunches. It's personal to her. Because she thinks that too many kids are out of shape. And surprisingly enough, you guys have developed an intense opinion about her issue. You don't like it because you can't eat what you want because they're serving slop in the cafeteria. Yes, they are. Now, the last two are rather easy. Consensus and polarized. A consensus opinion is simply this. It's shared by 75% of people or more. So, having a balanced budget, not being allowed to burn the flag, putting pedophiles in prison for life, those are pretty much opinions held by a vast majority of the population. 75% or greater is a very, very big consensus of the population. On the other hand, a polarized population is one that would be discussing abortion. This is in my third grade class last week. What I still find pretty amazing is that the pro-choice are more women, the pro-life are more males. Kind of weird. So gun control, abortion, the Equal Rights Amendment back in the 70s, all those are what we call polarized opinions. Less than 75% of Americans agree. And then with abortion, it's very polarized. So when we look at these types of opinions, we know that there's a lot of inconsistencies. In 1992, they were measuring dissatisfaction and satisfaction. 60% of Americans disapproved of George Bush and his handling of the presidency. There was little or no trust in government, something that we're going to look at a little bit later in this chapter. Yet at the same time, 90% of Americans were very proud of who they were. It should have been a little bit reflected in little or no trust in government. There's a general belief in the workings of democracy, over 60%, and yet we're very unhappy with our leadership. So that's why we poll. We want to see where Americans are at. And it comes up with some interesting things. So, I have something back here in the background of this. It's weird. You'll have a picture that you'll put in the background, it's okay, but this does not fit the model at all. So how do we measure? Well, we're going to measure public opinion on public support for having an election. But that's not the only way to measure public opinion. You can do it by straw polls, which are very attractive because there's no measure of the population that's voting. You can do it by anybody you think. Is there anything that yeah, there's one. There's 17 or 18 let's see if we were measuring this room here. It wouldn't be random. The only randomness would be that this is my first period. And second period, if we measured that, that would be the other randomness from a period that you're in. But we're not there yet. So the thing that we're going to look at is what we call a scientific poll. And I just want to go back up to elections for the first part of this. What is an election measure? It tells us what? An election. Who won and who lost, right? But does it tell us why people voted that way? Or why they voted for that candidate? No, it doesn't. So if we select election as the best example of a measurement of public opinion, that's only good up to a point. It is deceiving because it tells us who and it tells us what, but it doesn't tell us why. And straw polls are simply inaccurate. So we have to go with scientific polls. We're going to look at a couple of minutes. I'm just going to go through this today, and then tomorrow I'm going to give you some polls to look at, and we'll break them down so that you understand the dynamics of the poll. So the next two of them. So when we look at the construction of a poll, we're looking at the definition of the universe. And the universe is the population that's going to be measured. So it's the population to be measured. And you then have to figure out how we're going to do that. So we have to do it in order to get an accurate look at the population. We have to do it in a random way. And in a random, in what we call a random sampling, which in this case is random. Ulysses has as great a chance as Ashley, as Derek, as Jason, as Sarah has, of getting chosen to be part of a sample. That's why we call it random. So, in a random sample, each person in the universe has an equal chance of being selected. Now, how they do this is through census tracts. So they're going to be looking at a number of things. Are you single? Are you married? What's your income level? Are you an owner? Are you a renter? They're going to be looking at a ton of stuff so that each person in that random sample generally reflects the population as a whole. It's very science, that's why they call it scientific polling. And they do this, GIS software has been wonderful. They can, the GIS software, they can tell you, you know, of course, because you live there, but they can tell you, or they can tell how many bathrooms are in that house, how many people are living in that house, their registration, so on and so forth. The data now is much easier to get. And it may be adaptation for those who no longer have landlines, so they can call cell phones. They're able to get that data too. I've been called twice in the last two weeks, and given the part of two polls. One was on Prop 47. Prop 47 is the release, or the change in status for felonies. Yeah, I don't like laws like that to be done through public initiative simply because people don't usually have a master of all the things. So I'm voting no. It has some value in it. It has some value in it. So I'm voting no simply because this should be much more piecemeal. And they should be doing parts of it at one time to see how it works and how it fluctuates. This is just like, let's just do it. And I just don't think it's going to work all that well. So I'm voting no, simply because I think it's the wrong way to do it. But I think it has some value. People who have to commit minor laws should not be charged with felony. And then be put in prison. And then when three strikes kicks in, if you've committed your third minor felony, you're going to be in prison the rest of your life, and I have to deport you. And that's not right. But let's fix the small problem first to see if we resolve some larger issues. So remember, we have the scientific poll. You have an equal chance of everybody else of being chosen. Now, that means that these organizations, Rasmus, NBC Merits, Suffolk, Gallup, they hire a lot of people. They sell that data to politicians. But what it is there's a recognition that polling is expensive. So the selection of the sample, believe it or not, is going to be anywhere from 500 to 1,500 people. And you think to yourself, there's 330 million people in the United States. How do the measure of 500 to 1,500 people, how can that even begin to say or tell us how America thinks? Because they've judiciously looked at the data and brought people in that represent all segments of the population. They do a pretty good job of being nearly, sometimes spot on, nearly, sometimes they're close to how the population is actually thinking. So when they do this, they look at the census. They have to divide the nation into regions of equal population, West, South, New England, Midwest, so on and so forth. They then divide the regions into subregions. They then divide those subregions into more subregions, and then they make some selections. So there's a geographical component, there's an age, gender, ethnicity, race, you name it. Now, there's something called the sampling error. So, a sampling error is simply the reflection that for every group of, let's say, 500 voters, you're not going to get the same exact measurement of opinion out of those 500. So the first group, let's 100's easier. So the first group, let's say, is 51% anti-abortion. But the second group of 100 is only 49. Third group might be 47. Fourth group might be 52. You have the same elements, but you're not getting the exact same opinion. And pollsters know that for every group of 100, there's going to be some variability in the results. So what they do is they input a sampling error, and we see that that is put into a plus minus. So let's say that Ulysses is running for office, and poll A says Ulysses has 45%. Poll B says Ulysses has 48%. But let's go back to poll A. Poll A says he's got 45% with a sampling error of plus or minus 3. So what's the most he could have? 48. What's the least he could have? 42. It's that variability. And so the larger the group, the less variability there's going to be. That's why that 1,500 might be a little bit more valuable than the 500, but it takes a long time, much longer, to get 1,500 people and the answers from them than it takes 500. I'm just introducing sampling. ordinary for you today. We'll look at it real tomorrow. So we can reduce, is 1500 here, reduces sampling error. But here's the thing, above 1500, above 2000, there's no appreciable change in how, in the attendance of a group. So that's why most polling organizations stop at about 1500. So sampling error is simply the difference between the sample and the entire population, knowing that every group is going to have some slight differences. So the other thing that has to be noted is this. You have to write the question in as unbiased a way as possible. So let's say I put this, let's say that I'm a pro-life group. And my first question that Genevieve answers is, don't you think that abortion is murder? Is that a leading question? Yeah, number one, people will go, well, I don't want to be considered a murderer. And so they're going to agree with the question, even though they may not feel like that. That's a leading question. That is going to get biased results. So you have to formulate the question in a way that in which it does three things. You have to avoid what we call emotionally loaded questions. The question I just asked was emotionally loaded. Secondly, you have to reformulate the question again and again. Subtle changes in wording can vastly change the results that you're getting. You want to be as neutral as possible. This is all about neutrality. Because you want to know what people are actually thinking. You want to know what people are actually thinking. You don't want the question to give you the result. You want the person to give you the result of the question. Now the one thing that they are struggling with is the willingness of people to lie. And we see that that's definitely true with exit polls. The race in 2000 is the best example of that. But people sometimes lie. Maybe they don't like your organization. Maybe they don't like your paper. Or something like that. So they'll lie. They'll give you the exact opposite of how they feel. So that's a problem that pollsters have to deal with. That's why they ask you, has anybody been part of a poll yet? My God, the people from 47, they asked the same question seemingly five different ways to see if they could elicit a different response. And I answered it the same way every time. But I was on the phone with them for 30 minutes. It was a measure on, it was more about how prisoners should be treated, and should felonies be considered, but they would ask the same question subtly every time. It would be subtly a little bit different the next time they asked it. But I wouldn't change my opinion. No, they were trying to get, I think they were trying to get an illicit response. That's why it was so thorough. That's why it took 30 minutes. So the writing the question to avoid bias, better than neutrality is avoid bias. Again, you want a truthful response. You don't want a response that generally is what you want. You want to see. Groups will see that. Groups will see that that's a problem. Now, the opinions of groups. The selection of means of polling. This is telephone, cell. I've not seen any email polling at all. But this is the major way of getting it. And then, of course, face-to-face is the third. Face to face, though, is the most expensive. How many of you have been harangued by the people at the mall? Do they still do that? Yeah. Those are face to face. Those are not public opinion on politicians as much as they're public opinion on different products. That is what it is. Okay, so what do you have to worry about? Well, first and foremost, the opinions of different groups have to be brought in or factored in. We know that there's a gender gap. Right now, women favor Democrats, men favor Republicans. All the candidates are worried about minimizing the gender gap. So when you look at the sample, if 50.5% of the registered voters are women, then you've got to have something around that number in your sample. Does it do you any good if only 45% of your respondents are women? Or 60% of your respondents are women? Your sample is going to be skewed one way or the other. So here's some of the things that we know, and we're gonna hit this again and again. Women shifted to the Republican Party during the Roosevelt era. Eisenhower era. Women shifted to Clinton during the 1990s. These were what we call the soccer moms. These same soccer moms shifted to Bush after 9/11. They shifted back to Obama in 2008. Now, with ISIS, they seem to be shifting again. It could be interesting. The ones that aren't shifting, though, are single women. So the gender gap, there's a gender gap within the gender gap. Married women with children are much more likely to switch sides based on what's going on outside more than women without children or single women with children. Marriage and non-marriage seem to have an effect. There also is an age difference. Remember, there's the generation gap. 18 to 30-year-olds vote differently than those who are 50 and older. They look at things differently than those who are 50 and older. There's class. Class comes with examples of education and income. The more educated and the more money you make, the more likely you are to vote. But also, you have a different outlook. So for example, those with higher education and income will be less likely to support government direct assistance to people with less money and less education. There can be regional differences. Look at the difference between Southerners and New England, or California with the rest of the West. And then there are racial differences. There are an example of a race gap. So all those things have to be taken into account when we look at polling. It can be complicated, which is why we're going to be looking at real clear politics tomorrow in the polls as well. So why do the polls exist? Well, there are some reasons. How else is a politician going to find out where he or she stands or what's important to the public? So we know that polls inform the public of where Americans stand. Polls inform the candidates where Americans stand, so the candidates can develop their platforms. They inform the president and Congress on where Americans stand, and sometimes they take notice and sometimes they don't. Where are Americans at on quarantining those who have been from West Africa? 70% of say either don't let them in or put them in quarantine if they arrive. What's the administration do? Well, that's a bad thing. You shouldn't be doing that. So sometimes there is a disconnect between what the population is saying and what the office holders are doing. And then, what time is it? Okay, so we're just an hour off. How much time do we have? 6 minutes. Okay. 2 seconds. All right, so I just want to talk a little bit about exit polls for a minute. And I'm going to let you watch the video that I installed in here. I'll let you watch that. You can click on the link later on. But here's the problem with polls. Number one, there's a horse race mentality. So polling right now is focused almost entirely. I was watching Fox and I was watching CNN yesterday. And in both cases, they weren't really talking about the issues, but they were talking about who's behind and who's ahead. That's the horse race mentality. Is there any discussion of the issues? Rarely. They were talking about why Republicans aren't farther ahead. And the reason for that is Republicans have not been able to articulate a national issue, a national platform, which would attract voters. Secondly, polls can also pander or make politicians pander to the whims of the public. Why? The president was adamant a couple weeks ago that there would be no quarantine, there would be nothing. Boy, public opinion did not back that up. They had to continually move every couple days. Every couple days, they had to move closer to where the public was because there was such a disconnect on Ebola policy. So in a sense, you could say the president and his administration were pandering to public opinion. But then we get the exit polls. The exit polls are a problem. People lie. You walk out of a precinct. There's a pollster there. And they ask you, how did you vote? What were the issues that were important to you? And you tell that pollster the opposite of how you voted. We didn't really realize that was a problem until the election of 2000. Now, another thing that's a problem with exit polls is that our polls, we have basically a five-hour difference between Washington and Honolulu, Washington and Anchorage. The problem is the East Coast votes. It's 8 o'clock in the East. What time is it in the West? 5 o'clock. The West still has 2 more hours they can vote. Jimmy Carter in 1980, it was pretty much known within the first hour of the election that night in 1980 that he lost. So he goes out at 9 o'clock. Prime time in the East, and concedes the election, leaving Democrats in the West going, what the? Because polls were still open in the West for 2 more hours. Do you think Democrats went out and voted those last 2 hours in California and Colorado and other places? No, they didn't. Why bother? The president's already conceded. Why should I go out and vote for Carter now? So Carter, by coming out and conceding the election early, damaged Democratic candidates out in the West. People just decided, well, the election's already decided. I'm not going to vote. I'm going to eat dinner instead. So now you'll notice that almost anybody, even if it's obvious that they've lost, they will wait until polls close in the West to make any sort of decision as to what they're going to do. By that time, how late is it in the East? It's 11 o'clock. So they have to make some sort of decision between 10 o'clock and 11 o'clock what they're going to do. And that's why you'll see, like in 2012, Romney and Obama didn't show up on television until after 11 o'clock. Polls in the West have been closed. So we know that in 2000, this is probably the best election. In 2000, and I think Unprecedented is on YouTube, and I may have you watch that, look and answer some questions. Florida is divided into two time zones. Excuse me, guys. Florida is divided into two time zones. The thumb of the state is in the eastern time zone. But when you get up to the panhandle, which stretches across Georgia and Alabama, that's in the central time zone. And because, based on erroneous exit polls, the networks called the election for Gore early in the evening based on their exit polls in Florida. That discouraged turnout, which was Bush country, in the panhandle, which is where Pensacola is, and it's much more conservative. Turns out they were wrong, because a couple hours later, after the polls had closed in the panhandle, the networks pulled back their prediction and said, you know what? We don't think Gore's going to win Florida. We think Bush is going to win Florida. That was standard for about a couple hours. Then they looked at the polling again, and they decided, you know what, we can't call Florida for either candidate. The reason for that was the exit polling that they had taken was different from the actual results that were coming out of the counties. So we know that people lie. We now know that people lie. So the exit polls are a problem. Yeah, they lie. So I'm going to stop right here on the, excuse me, on the, on YouTube there is a video for you to watch. I've put the link there. I'll put the link in below it just as a text thing if you can't find it from here. But you should be able to. It's about a five, almost a 6 minute video. The problems of polling.